thank you for the opportunity to be here again and to talk. And this is a follow-up on the talk from last time on theology of the body. So if you didn't hear the talk from last time, it's not a big deal. Today's talk is still understandable, although some of the depths of the whys behind some of the principles that we'll talk about may not be quite as appreciable, but nevertheless, today's talk is okay if you hadn't heard the one on theology of the body. But theology of the body provides a framework in which to understand many of the issues in bioethics where human sexuality is part of the medical problem or the medical issue. So today we're going to talk about infertility. A lot of the principles that inform our decision-making on this are rooted in an understanding of theology of the body, and so last week's presentation helps to illuminate the things that we'll talk about today. So today's talk, last week's talk, was more sort of theoretical with some application, but it was much more in the abstract realm. This time, I want this talk today to be very practical. And this talk in many ways is aimed at couples who struggle with infertility. So this is a talk that at the end of it, I would like for couples to be able to go home with very practical tools in their hands. So last week, more sort of theoretical and intellectual, and this week is going to be much more concrete. So let's jump in. So for the opening slide, this is Abraham and Sarah from Marc Chagall from half a century ago. This is a biblical couple who struggled with infertility. You'll remember that Sarah, before she was renamed Sarah when she was Sarai, she had no children. And Abram, her husband, they had never been able to conceive. And so their conception ultimately of their son Isaac was this sign of God's providence and actually was linked into the Sunday readings from today. So they're a biblical couple who stand in some ways as people who experienced what many people struggle with today. So here's what we'll do today. We'll talk about several different topics within infertility. I'll start off giving you a little bit of background. I then want to lay out some of the guiding principles that we'll use to think about specific treatments that are available for infertility. We'll then apply those principles to some of those specific treatments. I want to give a little bit of a contrasting view of the secular view of sexuality and infertility treatment. And just as a comment on this, as you can anticipate, there's some difference in opinion here. But I don't want to bring this up so much to point the wagging finger at culture and at society as often happens, but rather to illustrate the divergence between a Catholic view and a secular view, again, serving the needs of a couple, so that a couple who's struggling with infertility can recognize the difference that they may encounter if they're going through treatment, and so that they may be better prepared, so that if they're going through treatment, they can recognize, well, here's where there may be some issues. And then finally, I'm going to synthesize everything that we've talked about into an organized approach for a Catholic couple struggling with infertility, how to proceed. So let's start off with some background. So infertility, from a clinical definition, is defined as the inability of a couple to conceive after a year. At some point in the married life of a couple, this will affect 25% of couples at some point. Doesn't mean that they're infertile permanently, but 25% of couples spend a year somewhere along the way unable to conceive. The kind of visual graphics of conception is that if you take many couples and just follow what happens as they're trying to conceive, after the first 6 months, 80% have conceived. By the end of the first year, 90% have conceived. So there's that 10% that remains, and that's the group that meets that definition of infertility. Now, interestingly, if you then follow forward for several more years, half of those remaining 10% will still conceive a child. And this is without fertility treatment. This is just naturally, they'll conceive a child on their own, which kind of illustrates that story of, you know, the often told story of a couple that has been unable to conceive, is pursuing adoption, and then in the midst of the adoption, the wife becomes pregnant. And indeed, the statistics reflect that over the next 3 years, so a pretty long stretch, half of the couples who haven't yet conceived will eventually conceive over the next 3 years. So eventually 95% will reach conception. very quick little bit of background. There's a variety of reasons why a husband and a wife may have difficulty conceiving a child. There's some male causes. Male causes are a substantial minority of the reasons. Less than 50%, but it's still a pretty good either contributing factor or the reason. And some of the reasons include decreased sperm production, which itself can be for a variety of other reasons, problems with erections, or what's called retrograde ejaculation, meaning that at orgasm, the ejaculation, instead of normally going forward, actually goes backwards into the bladder, and so the sperm don't come out. For women, again, a very quick overview, it could be a variety of different issues, ranging from problems with ovulation, meaning the woman's not releasing an egg. Many, many reasons for this. Mechanical blockages with the fallopian tubes, or abnormalities with the uterus. And so just a little quick anatomy, just to make some of those reasons make sense. The ovaries here and here are where the eggs are and where they develop. When the egg is released at ovulation, it's released into the opening of the fallopian tube. Typically, conception, fertilization, actually happens about right there. It's actually not, doesn't happen in the uterus. Usually happens out here, so the sperm have come up through the uterus, up the fallopian tubes, and meet the egg, typically right at the first segment of the fallopian tubes. So if the ovaries don't release an egg, or if the fallopian tubes are blocked, then conception is going to have a very difficult time happening. And then once conception has happened, if there are abnormalities in the uterus such that the embryo cannot implant into the lining of the uterus, then again the woman will never have a recognized pregnancy. She will have conceived, but not the embryo won't have implanted. Okay, that was the extent of the biology background you're going to get. So just the quick basics that you need. So let's talk about some of the guiding principles that we will use in order to evaluate some of the techniques and some of the medical interventions that are available. Okay, so the principles. The first principle I'm going to give is actually not a principle of fertility or infertility treatment, but is a fundamental principle of moral decision making, and it's this. One may never use evil so that good may result from it. One may never do evil so that good may result from it. This is a foundational principle of moral decision making that applies not only to bioethics, but to anywhere, any activity where a person is making a moral decision. And this is a principle that I think, at first hearing, makes a lot of sense. And then as you think about it a little bit more, it makes less sense. Because you think, well, what if I can accomplish a great good with a small evil? Shouldn't that be okay? But as you go deeper into it, and this actually goes outside of what we have the time to talk about today, but as you go deeper into this principle, it unfolds itself and makes even more sense that, yes, this is indeed true. We cannot use evil as a tool to accomplish good. So not only must the objective that we're trying to accomplish be good, but the way that we get there has to be good as well. Foundational principle that applies to all of moral thinking. So that's the background. Then some specific principles that apply to treatment of infertility. So the principles come from this document, Donum Vitae, the gift of life. This was a document that came out in 1987 and came from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith and provides a lot of guidance on this kind of medical decision making. So this is where all of our principles are going to come from, and this is the document that we're going to be referring to. First principle. This, I think, is the most useful and probably the most important principle in evaluating medical interventions for treating infertility. The intervention must assist marital intercourse as the source of conception. The intervention cannot replace marital intercourse. In the language of Donum Vitae, the document says, a medical intervention respects the dignity of persons when it seeks to assist the conjugal act, either in order to facilitate the performance or in order to achieve its objective once it has been normally performed. On the other hand, it sometimes happens that a medical procedure technologically replaces the conjugal act in order to obtain a procreation which is neither its result nor its fruit. So a medical intervention must facilitate marital intercourse as the source of conception and not replace it. So why is that? It's actually because of what we talked about last time. It's because of the principles in theology of the body. So this principle can stand alone, but this principle makes sense in the light of theology of the body. So remember what we talked about. What is marriage? So marriage is the icon of the inner life of the Trinity. It's a representation through the person and through our bodies of the way that God works within God. So remember from last time when we talked, when God the Father gives himself totally to the Son, and when God the Son gives himself totally to the Father, what happens? Who comes from that? It's the Holy Spirit. Remember that? That's the procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father and the Son. So for a husband and wife, when a husband and a wife give themselves totally, sexually, to each other in marriage, what happens? Who comes from that? The child. And so as marriage stands as an icon of the Trinity, a representation of the relationship between the first and second persons of the Trinity, what we see also is that that analogy, that representation, is carried forward even further in the procession of the Holy Spirit, which has its own mirror in the procreation of children. And so what's happened is last time we talked about the way that God has planted this nuptial or marital nature into our being. What he also has done is written into our biology a similar kind of analogy to God himself, and that is in the procreation of our children. And so what's happened is that in this icon of the Trinity, that's where God has placed procreation, the creation of new human life. So then as we come back to this principle and we say that medical interventions must assist marital intercourse, they must assist a husband and wife making love as the way that the husband and wife create their children, what that does is that's affirming the meaning and the value of marriage, marital intercourse, and procreation. A technological intervention that removes procreation from the marital embrace is not following the meaning of the icon. It's not following the meaning of the way that God has made us and the way that God has written his nature into our nature. So that's the why. That's why theology of the body is important for this kind of medical issue. Okay, so that's the first principle. As Donavite says in summation of this, the procreation of the new person must be the fruit and sign of the mutual self-giving of the spouses, of their love, and of their fidelity. So it affirms the meaning and the beauty of their marriage. Second principle, the child has the right to be conceived, carried in the womb, brought into the world, and brought up within marriage. So this is an interesting right. You know, if someone were to say to me, I'd like you to write out the list of fundamental human rights that you can think of, I probably would not have come up with this one. This is actually, I think this is very peculiar. I remember when I first was reading Donum Vitae and I read this line and I thought, huh, well that's interesting. I'm not sure I get this completely. But again, if we continue to think about this in light of theology of the body, it actually makes sense. So what we just talked about is marriage as the representation of the inner life of God. So let's go a little bit further with that, and let me ask this question. Let me frame it this way and then ask the question. The last principle that we just talked about sees the meaning of marriage and of marital intercourse from the perspective of the husband and the wife. When they give themselves totally to one another, they open themselves to fruitfulness and, if biology goes, conceive a child. That's from the parent's perspective. See it from the child's perspective. Let's go back to the Trinity. If you could say to the Holy Spirit, if you're just having a conversation with God, and you said, Holy Spirit, where did you come from? Where do you come from? What's the answer? The answer from the Holy Spirit is, I come from the total gift of self between God the Father and God the Son. That is my origin. That is my ongoing eternal procession. And so take that and think about the child. actually think about each of us, because each one of us is a child of our parents. So I could say to each of you and to myself, where did you come from? And hopefully, ideally, the answer should be that I came from the total gift of self between my mother and my father. That's the way that God has written himself into marriage and the marital embrace. And so as we look at that and see it through the perspective of the child and including through the perspective of the Holy Spirit, what we see then is that indeed the child has this right to be conceived within this icon of the Trinity, within marriage. Does that make sense? Okay. Let me go on to the third principle, which is this. The conceived child has equal human dignity as his or her parents. Essentially, we cannot use children as objects or as tools. So this calls up, actually, let me give you the quote from Donum Vitae. In his unique and irrepeatable origin, the child must be respected and recognized as equal in dignity to those who gave him life. So if you think at the moment of conception, at the moment of fertilization, what you have there is a new human being, a new human person. That person warrants all of the same treatment with human dignity that any other person deserves. And so in evaluating treatments of infertility, it's important to recognize that the way that the child is treated must be consistent with the child's human dignity. And essentially, the child has to be treated with the same dignity as the parents or as any other person. This calls to mind last time when we talked about, remember lust and the use of another person? Well, coming back again to John Paul II, this is from Love and Responsibility, which he wrote when he was think a bishop, if I remember, but he wrote what became called the personalistic norm. This is in his book, Love and Responsibility. He said the person cannot be treated as an object of use and as such the means to an end. The person is a good towards which the only proper and adequate attitude is love. So this is John Paul II's vision and view of the person. This is the way that we need to treat other persons, with love. And so that's what informs this third principle that comes from Donum Vitae, which is that the child should be treated with the same dignity as the parents or as any other person. A quick implication of this that I want to name, and this is a little tough to swallow, but it's important to say, is the recognition that a couple does not have a right to have a child in quite the same way that they have a right, for instance, to choose where to live, or the right to choose what parish they go to, or other kinds of decisions that you make. What the couple has is that through their marriage, they have the right to give themselves totally to one another. But they don't have the right to a child because of this principle. Not immediately apparent, I don't think. But let me frame it this way. I'm married, so the question would be, do I have the right to make a woman my wife? Well, no, I don't. What do I have the right to do? I have, well, not anymore, but I have the right to court a woman. I have the right to pursue her. I have the right to hopefully encourage her that this is her vocation to become my wife, but I can't make her my wife in the sense of like being like, okay, you, up to the altar, let's go. I can't do that. Why not? Fundamentally, because that violates the dignity of that person. That person has their own free will, their own vocation given to them by God, and so I can't just impose upon them, here's what you're going to do. So I have the right to pursue and the right to court a woman, as I did with my wife when we were courting. But ultimately, her decision to become my wife is her decision, as it was my decision to become her husband. So in the same sense, as we come back to think about children, I don't have the right to a child. I have the right to give myself completely to my wife, but it is then God's gift, whether we conceive or not. Tough concept, but important. So as I summarize our three principles coming from Donum Vitae, from this document, the gift of life, Number one, the medical intervention has to assist marital intercourse as the source of conception rather than replace it. Number two, the child has the right to be conceived, carried, delivered, and brought up in marriage. And number three, the conceived child has equal human dignity to the parents and to everyone else. So let's talk about application. Let's now begin talking about specific medical treatments, and let's review them in the light of these principles. So let's start off with artificial insemination. So real quickly, the biology of artificial insemination is this. Sperm are taken from a man, and they are inserted into the uterus of a woman. Sometimes into the vagina, but usually into the uterus of a woman. So that's the biology. That's the extent of artificial insemination. So here's the scenario. A single woman undergoes artificial insemination using sperm from an anonymous donor. Anonymous donor means from a sperm bank. Someone, a guy who has donated sperm that's then frozen, and she goes there to get that sperm. So let's assess that in the light of these principles. And let's actually go from bottom to top. So in this scenario, does the conceived child have equal human dignity as his or her parents? In some ways, no, but by and large, particularly when we come to other medical interventions, I think we'll see that this one's actually not such a big deal in this kind of scenario. So I'm actually going, for this one, I'm going to say that the human dignity is not so much of an issue. And you'll especially see that when we hold it in contrast to some of the other technological interventions that are available. In this scenario, the child has the right to be conceived in marriage, carried in the womb in marriage, brought into the world in marriage. Is that right being upheld? Clearly no. How about the first one? The intervention, artificial insemination, does it assist marital intercourse or is it replacing it? It's clearly replacing it. In this scenario, there is no intercourse, marital or non-marital. There's no intercourse. So in this case, the action of a technician in inserting the sperm into the uterus has taken the place of intercourse in creating the child. So in this scenario, artificial insemination violates two of the principles that we have. Let me give you another scenario. A married couple is infertile because the man has retrograde ejaculation, meaning that the sperm go backwards. They go up into the bladder instead of forwards. So the woman undergoes artificial insemination using her husband's sperm. So let's look at that one in the light of these principles. So the conceived child, are his or her fundamental human rights violated in this conception? Essentially, no. Is the child being conceived in marriage? Yes. Is the intervention replacing or is it assisting marital intercourse? It's replacing it. So there is this child conceived did not come from the husband and the wife making love to one another. It came from sperm being taken from the man, inserted into the uterus of the woman by a technician. And that's where this child came from. So what we see in this consideration of these principles and this way of intervening in infertility, what we see is that artificial insemination, depending on the scenario, may or may not violate some of these principles, but at its heart, artificial insemination replaces marital intercourse as the source of conception. So what we see then is that marital intercourse is incapable of assisting marital intercourse. And so this is one that, with Catholic eyes, as we turn to this and see what it means, we recognize that this is a technical intervention that we cannot rightly choose. Make sense? Okay. If you have questions, definitely throw them out at the end. We'll come back. Okay. So let's talk about another technique. Let's talk about medications that are used to stimulate ovulation. So the scenario here would be that, or the biological background would be that the treating physician uses medications that will stimulate ovulation or in some scenarios perhaps treat an underlying medical condition where the medical condition itself is the reason that the woman's not ovulating. So you're using medications that ultimately facilitate the release of an egg. There's some separate issues that come up with this that are related to the specific drug used. So for instance, some drugs can stimulate the ovaries quite a bit, and you can end up releasing lots of eggs, which could then raise chance of multiple conceptions, but then carry some risk that goes with it. There's other technical considerations for other medications, but those are sort of case by case. In the core sense, what we're talking about is medications that, whatever the specific technical considerations, will stimulate release of an egg. Here's the scenario. A couple has been unable to conceive because the wife has polycystic ovarian syndrome. This is a condition that interferes with normal menstrual cycles and interferes with ovulation. So the woman frequently in polycystic ovarian syndrome is not releasing an egg. She's not ovulating. So her physician recommends a common medication called clomiphene or Clomid to stimulate ovulation. So what do you think about this scenario? Let's talk about the principles. And let's talk about the first principle first. Let's go from top down this time. So is this intervention, using this medication to stimulate ovulation, is it facilitating the husband and wife's intercourse as the source of conception, or is it replacing it? It's actually facilitating it. So if you think about it, what happens here is that prior to using the medication, when the husband and wife make love, the wife isn't able to release an egg, and so she's essentially rarely fertile. What the medication does is it stimulates the egg release so that when the husband and wife make love, there is an egg in the fallopian tube. Remember the diagram I was pointing at? There's an egg in the fallopian tube for the sperm to encounter, for fertilization or conception to occur, and then the embryo implants into the uterus, and 2 weeks later she's got her pregnant. But positive pregnancy test. So this is an instance where the medical intervention, clomiphene, is providing kind of the background biological conditions for marital intercourse to produce children. So the first principle, totally fine in this instance. Does that make sense? Okay, so what about the second point? The child has the right to be conceived in the womb, brought into the world, and brought up within marriage. Not an issue. We've got a married couple. And then the third one, the conceived child has equal human dignity as his or her parents. Are there any issues here with the child's rights being violated or their human dignity being violated? No, there's no issue. So here's an instance. The use of fertility drugs for a couple, Catholic couple, struggling with infertility, legitimate. Now, like I said, there's some technical considerations that requires prudence, so that the woman isn't exposing herself to great danger with the medications. There's some considerations there, but at least coming out of the gates, using medications to facilitate fertility is fine. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Let's talk about in vitro fertilization. This is a big one. So, statistics here. Most of you know someone who has been through in vitro fertilization, whether you realize it or not. Most of you do. So the statistics that I saw from 2002, so an old statistic but still illustrates the point, in the United States, 300,000 children had been born who had originally been conceived through in vitro fertilization. It was 2002. In 2007, 2008, somewhere around there, approximately 1% of the children being born in the United States were from in vitro fertilization. So this is very common. So a lot of couples go through this. So that's the background in terms of the numbers with it. So what about the evaluation of it? What do we make of this? So for a show of hands, how many of you know what the church teaches on in vitro fertilization? Yeah. For those of you who know, how many of you feel like absolute certainty, I get this, I know exactly what the issues are, and I can explain this to someone? Yeah, so one person in the crowd. So, and that's exactly it. I mean, when somebody has a lazy Saturday afternoon, the chances are you're not going to go sit down and read some Catholic bioethics, right? You're probably going out to go mulch the garden, you're going out to have some time with your kids, you're going to do something else. You're not sitting down to read bioethics. So this is the kind of thing that, you know, because the science of in vitro fertilization is, you know, pretty sophisticated, it's not something that you just kind of look at it as Catholic in the pews and say, oh, yeah, okay, I see the issues. I know what the deal is with this. So this is one that many Catholics have no idea what the church teaches and may not even know that the church has a teaching on this. So I want to spend a little bit of time with this one. Okay, so let me give you the background. Let me give you the biology of this, because the biology of in vitro fertilization helps to make sense of the moral issues that go with it. So here's the biology. What happens is eggs are stimulated using typically fertility medications, like we talked about in the last scenario. Eggs are stimulated to begin developing in the ovaries of a woman. Those eggs are then retrieved, typically using an ultrasound-guided, very fine needle, so fairly low risk, even though needles give a lot of people the willies. So the eggs are retrieved, then sperm are taken from whatever source, whether the spouse or an anonymous donor, like from a sperm bank, and in the lab, the sperm and the eggs are combined. When the combination happens, that's fertilization, that's conception. So at that point, you have, at the moment of fertilization, a zygote, i.e., a new human person. That you're doing in the lab what normally happens in the fallopian tubes at the moment of conception. So then these embryos are allowed to grow for several days till they reach a multicellular stage and then are implanted into the uterus of the woman. That's basically what in vitro fertilization means. Now, a couple considerations here, a couple of additional things to mention is at this stage, the stage after the fertilization, while the embryos are growing but before they've been implanted, there's a couple of other things that also will sometimes happen. One is that when you get to a multicellular stage of the growing new child, the lab person, can remove some of the cells and assess those cells for genetic abnormalities, chromosomal defects like Down syndrome, specific gene defects like, I think cystic fibrosis is one that can be tested for. So then you can do what's called pre-implantation genetic diagnosis on the embryos. The other thing that can be done is that oftentimes multiple embryos will be created, and so some will be implanted and some will be frozen in liquid nitrogen and set aside for later use. So that's some of the other technique. That doesn't have to happen with in vitro fertilization, but very often does. Okay, so that's the background. That's the biology and the science of what's happening with in vitro fertilization. So let's spend a moment with a scenario and let's go through our principles. So here's the pure case, as you might consider it. You've got a married couple who uses in vitro fertilization to create one embryo who is then implanted. So the question is, what do you think? How do you evaluate this? So let's hold this up against the principles that we have. So let's go from bottom to top on this one. So third principle, is the conceived child treated with equal human dignity as his parents? But actually say no. Why not? Because the child is being treated as an object of medical intervention. The child is being grown in a petri dish, being fed nutrients to grow appropriately. The child is being inserted into a pipette and shot up into the uterus. So these are the ways of being treated that people at the three-day-old stage of life should not be subjected to. This is using the child as a product of manufacturing. So this is a problem. We'll talk more in a minute about some other problems that come up with this. In this scenario, is the child being conceived within marriage? Yes, got a married couple. First principle, though, is this intervention assisting marital intercourse or is it replacing it? Completely replacing it. In fact, you could even envision this couple never having had intercourse and conceiving children. So if on their wedding night, if they decided, let's not consummate our marriage, but tomorrow let's go and undergo in vitro fertilization, they could conceive children, never having had intercourse. So clearly, in vitro fertilization replaces marital intercourse as the source of children. The children are conceived by the action of the lab technician who withdraws the eggs from the woman, takes the sperm from the man, and combines them in the lab. Typically, well, approximately 50% of the time, the way that the actual conception happens is the egg is held in place, a single sperm is injected directly into the egg. It's called intracytoplasmic sperm injection. I think I said that right. So clearly, that moment of fertilization and conception, there's no parents anywhere to be seen. This is happening at the hands of the lab technician. So in vitro fertilization completely replaces marital intercourse as the source of the procreation of children. Pretty significant. Let me give you the real world case. And indeed, the news has given us an instance with Ms. Suleiman recently. But I wrote this one prior to her. A single woman has multiple embryos created by in vitro fertilization using a sperm donor, or using donor sperm, sorry. Several of the embryos are screened for genetic disorders. One embryo carries a disorder and is discarded. Two unaffected embryos are implanted, and the rest are frozen and put into storage. So this is not an unusual case. So let's talk about this one in the light of the principles. So as we just talked about, in vitro fertilization replaces marital intercourse as the source of the procreation of the children who are conceived. And indeed, in this case, we can see that. A single woman, there's no mention of intercourse at all in the scenario, and yet she has children. The child who is conceived in this scenario is not being conceived within the context of marriage. And indeed, as we see some of the applications that are brought to bear in the setting of in vitro fertilization, we see the children who are conceived treated very clearly as objects. What we see is that some of the children have cells removed from them to be analyzed, and what we see is that if the child who has the genetic defect, or if the child has the genetic defect, is discarded, meaning destroyed, meaning killed. And then others are frozen in liquid nitrogen. And so, you know, the statistics are 500,000 or 1,000,000 who are frozen in liquid nitrogen. Being frozen in suspended animation is not fitting with human dignity. That's not what's supposed to be happening to someone at the fifth day of life, at the seventh day of life. They're supposed to be growing in their mother's uterus. So what we see in the real world scenario of this one is that we see all of the principles that guide our thinking on infertility treatment being violated by this real-world application of in vitro fertilization. Let's talk about surrogacy for a minute. So surrogacy, it pops in and out of the news here and there. But fundamentally, what it boils down to is a woman who becomes pregnant with sperm from a man who she's not married to, typically through artificial insemination. She gets pregnant, and she's got a contract in place to give up the child at delivery to the couple who have retained her services, essentially. Or the other way that surrogacy happens is a woman becomes pregnant via in vitro fertilization with a child she has no biological connection to. So the child's conceived through in vitro fertilization using another woman's eggs, another man's sperm, and implanted into her uterus. And same scenario, when she delivers, she gives up the child. Okay, scenario. A couple is infertile because the wife is unable to conceive. They sign a contract with another woman stating that she will undergo artificial insemination with the husband's sperm, carry the child she conceives, and give the child to the couple at birth. So as we look at our principles, is this intervention, artificial insemination, assisting marital intercourse or replacing it? Replacing it, yeah, clearly. So this is artificial insemination, which we talked about at the beginning. It's a technique that invariably replaces marital intercourse. Second, is the child being conceived and carried in the womb and brought into the world within marriage? No. The child's being brought up in marriage, being raised in marriage, but not conceived in marriage. And so as we talked about that the way that God places procreation within the icon of the Trinity, within the representation of his own inner life, what we see is that in this scenario of surrogacy, that icon is not truly being represented, not being re-presented to the world. And finally, is this child being treated with the equal human dignity as the parents? No. Why not? Because this child is an object of a contract, like the car that you agree to make monthly payments on for the next 3 years until you've paid it off. And if you don't pay it off, the bank comes and takes your car. The child, in this instance, is a term in a contract, rather than a human being deserving the full human dignity of every other human being on earth. Does that make sense? Okay. Surrogacy, if you'll recall from our biblical example of Abraham and Sarah, is what Abraham and Sarah turned to try to have a child. You remember Hagar? It's the maidservant of Sarah. She was then Sarai. Her names hadn't been changed yet. Sarai said to Abram, have sex with her. She'll conceive a child. It was surrogacy. And she gave birth to Ishmael. And you remember what happened in the interaction within this household is when Hagar became pregnant, she became disdainful of Sarai, to the point where Sarai drove her out into the desert after she delivered, so that both Hagar and Ishmael would die in the desert. So what we see in the biblical example of a couple struggling with infertility is that as they turned to this way of addressing their problem, they got into trouble. And essentially, it required God's intervention to come in and save the life of Ishmael in the desert. So this is surrogacy in Scripture. Okay, last one we'll talk about is treatment for erectile dysfunction. So this is the little blue pill that has gotten lots of attention. So this doesn't have to be just Viagra that applies here, but any treatment for erectile dysfunction. So if fundamentally here, a mechanical issue, if the man is unable to have an erection adequate for intercourse, then it becomes very difficult to have intercourse and conceive a child. So how do we evaluate treatments for that? Because that can be a source of infertility for a couple. So here's your scenario. A married couple is unable to conceive because the husband cannot attain an erection as a result of nerve injury. His physician prescribes Viagra, which is successful in treating his erectile dysfunction. So how do we assess this scenario? Let's look at our principles. Is this intervention assisting marital intercourse or replacing it? It's assisting it. So, guy's got a medical problem because of which he's unable to have an erection, and through the medication, he now is able to have an erection, and because of that, he's now able for him and his wife to make love to one another and conceive a child. So, this intervention facilitates marital intercourse. Is this child being conceived, carried, brought into the world, and brought up within marriage? Absolutely. That's the details of the scenario. And is the child in his or her conception being treated with the equal dignity as the parents? Yeah, there's no issue here. So yeah, this is a scenario where if a couple is infertile because the man has erectile dysfunction, treating the erectile dysfunction, totally fine, zero issues. Because I know some folks have asked the question, I mean, I've been in conversations where folks have said, well, gosh, is this okay to use? I mean, as a Catholic, can I use Viagra? And the answer is absolutely. Yeah, there's no problem at all, as long as you're using it for marital intercourse. Yes, absolutely. Okay. Let me spend just a minute talking a little bit about the secular view, and I want to hold up in contrast to the three principles that we've just talked about, a contrasting view. And like I said at the beginning, I don't necessarily want to do this just to, you know, flame the fans of culture war, but rather to identify for you that the perspective that is at large is not necessarily consistent with a Catholic perspective. So for the sake of a couple that may be dealing with infertility and pursuing treatment for infertility, it's important to recognize that for that couple, they probably need to be advocates for what they will and will not accept. So here's what I want to point out. First, we talked about marriage and the importance of marital intercourse as the source, the location of the procreation of children. So here's a statement. Traditional marriage has changed markedly in recent years as a result of high divorce and out-of-wedlock birth rates, adoption, assisted reproduction, recognition of women's rights, the gay rights movement, and other social and economic factors. This document that I took this from continues to say, fertility programs should treat all requests for assisted reproduction equally without regard to marital status or sexual orientation. So what we see then is as we looked at those first couple of principles, marital intercourse is the source of conception of a child, this statement runs contrary to that. As we looked at the importance of the child being conceived within marriage, within that icon of God's own self, what we see here is that that is not affirmed. And in fact, any other view is equally affirmed. So where did this quotation come from? This is a statement from the Ethics Committee of the American Society for Reproductive Medicine. So there is a substantial divergence from a Catholic view of the meaning of marriage, sexuality, and reproduction that is woven into the fabric of the average cultural view, I would say, and specifically of the view of some, perhaps many, who treat infertility. To go a little further, to begin bringing up that third principle, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, which we talked about with in vitro fertilization, used for sex selection in order to prevent the transmission of serious genetic diseases is ethically acceptable. Meaning, if a couple is going through in vitro fertilization and the man, for instance, carries a genetic disease, and they're trying to figure out, you know, is this disease getting passed on? But it's only going to be passed on to male children. It's not going to get passed on to female children. What these guys are saying is you can use pre-implantation genetic diagnosis to figure out, is this a boy embryo or a girl embryo, so that you can prevent the transmission of the disease. This group had said, we're not so crazy about using sex selection just because you want a boy or just because you want a girl. We're like, we think this is inappropriate. This is from 1999. However, this is from last month. No, sorry, 2 months ago, February. Fertility Institutes, which is a business that treats infertility, their headline, 100% sex selection, family balancing, and genetic embryo screening. If you see the physician sitting at the table, you see what he's holding in his hands, cards with a male or female symbol. Their advertisement is, if you want a boy, we'll give you a boy. If you want a girl, we'll give you a girl. So as we look at the principles that inform our thinking on this as Catholics, what is important to recognize is that that view is not necessarily shared by everyone. And so for a couple who is going through infertility, it's important to be aware of that. Doesn't mean that, you know, you need to be in a hostile, conflictual relationship with the fertility physician who's treating the condition, but it's important to be aware so that you can say, I'm sorry, we can't do this, but we will do this. That make sense? Okay, so let's synthesize this. So, you know, I've talked about wanting to make this practical. If you've got a Catholic couple who has been unable to conceive for a year, they're meeting the clinical definition of infertility, and they're trying to figure out, what do we do? How do we proceed with this? I want to pull all this together to give a synthesized view of how to proceed. So, the starting point is this. But actually, let me back off for a second. Prior to making any moral decision, I want to give you a starting point, and then let me identify that. This is applicable to any kind of moral decision, but then we're going to specifically talk about it in the context of infertility. So with any moral decision, where you're trying to figure out what should I do, here's the starting point. Total self-abandonment to God. If you're facing a moral decision, any moral decision, not just infertility, but Lord, should I propose to this woman? We're talking about courtship earlier. Should I take this job? Should I resign from this job? Should I fill in any blank? The starting point is a radical openness to what God's will is. This is the language of the saints, total self-abandonment to God. Do you have any idea how difficult this is, both in practical terms, but also in the very real application? I mean, because I want what I want. If God wants something different, well, you know, we'll talk about it. But I want what I want. But also, sometimes wanting what God wants is very difficult. If you remember the words of Christ himself, remember when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me." but not as I will, as you will. So that's the starting point, openness to God. Okay, the second step in moral decision making is discernment of what God wants you to try to do. So I put try in italics because that's an important point. You know, very often when we think about discernment, we say, okay, God, what do you want me to do? But really, I think the better question is, God, what do you want me to try to do? Because we don't necessarily measure our faithfulness to God and whether we've accomplished our goal or not. So for instance, when a few years ago, before I moved back to North Carolina, I was in a rosary group, and one of the guys in the group had been in the seminary, but then recognized that that wasn't his vocation, and he left the seminary. So the question could be, when he was going into the seminary, hadn't God wanted him to be a priest? And so why then did he leave? Did God change his mind? Well, no. So what the answer was that God had wanted him to try to be a priest. But that ultimately wasn't God's vocation for him. There was something for this individual in his experience in seminary that was formative for him and that was a necessary experience that he needed in his personal growth and in the trajectory of his life so that he then could go on to do what God had wanted for him. So it's important as we think about discernment. God, what do you want me to try to do? Whether I accomplish it or not, point me in the right direction and I will go in that direction until you tell me to go in a different direction. Okay, and then the third point is once you've discerned what God's will is for you to try to do, you then pursue it using legitimate means. You go in that direction using good means that God presents to you. Okay, so you've got a couple who is infertile, unable to conceive for a year. They have abandoned themselves to God's will, and what they have discerned is that God would like them to try to have a child. So what do? It's been a year. So Catholics have thought about this. This is not a new question. This is not an unthought of question. And I'm going to summarize in a super condensed way. This is the thought that comes from a physician named Thomas Hilgers, who works with the Paul VI Institute and has an organization called the Natural Procreation, NAPRO technology. I'm going to get the original words wrong. Here's his stair-step sequence of how he proposes that a couple approaches infertility. So the starting point, the bottom step, stands for the Creighton method. So this is one of the methods of natural family planning. It's kind of funny. Very often we think of natural family planning as a way that Catholics don't get pregnant. But it's not that. Natural family planning is a way for a woman to recognize where she is in her fertility cycle so that she can carry out God's will for what she should try to do. If she should try not to get pregnant, it allows her to recognize when she's fertile so that she and her husband can abstain. But if God's vocation is for the couple to try to get pregnant, using natural family planning allows the couple to recognize, I'm fertile now. So for Dr. Hilgers, his starting point is he says the couple should be using natural family planning to recognize when the woman is fertile. Make sure if you're having trouble, make sure you are trying at the right time. When that egg's being released, make sure there's some sperm there waiting. It's essentially his starting point. Assuming that hasn't worked or doesn't work, then his next step, he then talks about investigating what's going on, checking hormone levels, considering an ultrasound, laparoscopy, the SHSG is selective salpingohistrogram. So investigating to see if the tubes are open or not, going up to the ovaries. So doing some investigation, asking the question, what the heck's up? What's going on here? Then he says, you treat what you find, see what happens. If that's still not working, then you consider not only continuing to treat what you found, but considering adding medications to improve ovulation, like we talked about earlier on, using fertility drugs. And then he says, if that continues not to work, adoption. Consider adoption. So often, this is an option that we don't really think about so much, but yet is the option that is always waiting for us if we're unable to conceive. I'm going to put this in, instead of in a graph form, we can put it in, lay out the words of it. He says, start with NFP, evaluate medical problems, treat what you find, use acceptable means to assist in conception and consider adoption. And because of what we talked about with the divergence of the principles that inform how we treat infertility, it's important for a Catholic couple to be clear in their limits. So So that's essentially the synopsis of how an infertile couple approaches the treatment of their infertility. Now, I want to leave you with some resources. So first, the Couple League, they have a book called The Art of Natural Family Planning. There's a couple of different techniques of approaching NFP. This is one of them. This is one that I'm the most familiar with. This is the courses that I had gone through. So their website, ccli.org, and their book, which was rewritten about 2 years ago, so it's updated and much more user-friendly than it used to be. Donum Vitae itself, it's a great document. It's very short. It's all of 8 pages, and it's not super philosophical, so it's very approachable. An average person in the pews could open up Donum Vitae, read it, and understand it. So unlike Theology of the Body, where you hurt your brain thinking through it, this is very approachable. Other resources, NAPRO Technology, that's affiliated with Dr. Hilgers, who I was just mentioning, and then the affiliated institute, the Paul VI Institute. Another thing to point out, this isn't infertility directly, but you remember I mentioned discerning God's will for what you should try to do. There's a very good essay on the process of discernment that breaks it down into very tangible steps by Father Peter Ryan, who is a professor, I think, of moral theology at Mount St. Mary's Seminary up in Emmitsburg, Maryland. A fantastic priest and a very good teacher with a very good essay, which you can look up online, and that's the Google search if you want to find it. And then finally, you know, I was looking for online, essentially, support resources. I couldn't find a whole lot, but I did find this one, CatholicInfertility.org, which is a website that is maintained by a couple, I think, in Cincinnati, that has just some of the experiential things of a couple that's going through infertility and essentially provides some support. So potentially worth a look. All right. Well, thank you once again for your time, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. So yeah, so it's a good question. So for those who didn't, how can you tell if a man's sperm count is sort of running below the threshold that's going to assist in, or that's going to be adequate for fertility? It's a great question. So, because if you think about it, like, well, if you're going to look at the sperm in a lab, how are you going to get them to the lab? So as it turns out, this is an interesting and very creative solution to the problem. If a couple uses a condom with a hole in it, then a few of the sperm are going to end up sort of stuck in the condom. Most will go forward through the hole, and then you essentially take what you've got left to the lab and then assess that way. Is that what you were getting at? Yeah. So it's, you know, if you read the desired collection technique for an infertility or a fertility treatment, that's not necessarily what they would propose, but for a Catholic couple that is going through that step of evaluating the underlying disease or the underlying process that may be contributing to the infertility, that's a way that a Catholic couple can approach this issue and address or investigate this particular problem. Pretty creative, I would say. All right, well, thank you very much.